Gaza Freedom March to bring people into Gaza, because we went there 5 days after the massacre that took place in Gaza, and we went there to see, because you weren't getting the straight stuff from our news. We knew that. And we're going, we didn't know enough about the subject. So Ann Wright said, let's go. And so if anybody knows Colonel Ann, you don't say no, you just go. And so we got on a plane, we went to Egypt, we went to the border of Gaza. It was January 28th, and it was bloody cold. And they were saying, nobody can get in, nobody can get in, nobody can get in. There were wealthy people that lined up on the border, these sheikhs from Oman and Dubai. They wanted to bring in goods, and they said, you can't go in. Well, Colonel Ann, Medea, they get in. So we were in Gaza, and we saw what took place in Gaza, and it was a massacre. And I could describe to you untold stories of the craziness and the devastation and the murder that I saw there. But anyway, this to bring this back to Tahrir Square, we said the only way that people will know about what's going on in Gaza is to bring people to Gaza, because it's been isolated. It's called the world's largest open-air prison. It's only 45 kilometers by 8 kilometers wide. But the people are amazingly filled with hope. So we've been doing these trips to Gaza, and I was in Cairo to bring 30 people into Gaza. And I was there negotiating with the Egyptian foreign ministry to get my group in. And a friend of mine called me and said, hey, there's from the April 6th movement, which is now okay, it's legal. Back then it was very not legal. And the April 6th said, why don't you meet me in Shubra, where, if anybody's been watching the news, Shubra is where the Coptic Christians were recently massacred in Cairo. It's about 8 kilometers outside the center of downtown Cairo, from Tahrir Square. And I went out there and I expected to see the same old thing, because we brought 1,400 people into Cairo for the Gaza Freedom March. And we caused all kinds of problems when Egypt said, you're not, at first they said we could go, and then they said, no, you can't go to Gaza. So there were major protests because French people and American people and Canadian people and Australian people and people from India and people from South Africa were there. And they just don't get, you can't come in groups of six under martial law. They don't understand that. And they don't understand that you can't protest. So they protested, serious protest in Cairo. And the Egyptians saw what was going on and they joined in our protest. Some of them were severely beaten and jailed, but they stepped out. So fast forward, a year later, I was in Cairo and I went to Shubra and I saw what usually is, you see 100 Egyptians get together, 6 get beaten and arrested. The rest run. In that day, there were 500 people in Shubra Circle, the roundabout, and it was massive. And they did not back down. The police were coming in flanks, and they walked right up to them. And they did not stop. They kept pushing. The police were like this. Push back, push back, push back. And finally, they pushed through the police, which was absolutely amazing for Egyptians to push through the police. I was stunned. Imagine what an Egyptian 40 years under martial law would feel like. You know, I mean, it must have been amazing for them. And they scattered out throughout the area of Shubra to head to Tahrir Square. And there were signs that they were carrying, and I don't read Arabic, but I could see the artwork in them, and they were saying, Christian and Muslim together, we are one hand. That was their slogan, we are one hand. They're still one hand, trust me. They went down to Tahrir Square. There was a major confrontation with the police, rock throwing, water truck turned over, lots of water going everywhere, and it was some tear gas. But it was not over at that point. And I thought to myself, oh, well, the police are just going to wait until 3 o'clock in the morning. Half of the people by 10:30 at night had already left. They're just going to go in and beat a bunch of people and everybody will run. Well, what happened was the police didn't take that tactic. They drove trucks and armored vehicles and big giant paddy wagons, and they came firing hundreds of tear gas canisters all at once. Now, it was very strange because the wind was actually blowing towards the police. So, I mean, I don't know what they were thinking because half of them were on the ground. They didn't have gas masks. They didn't have any protection from the tear gas, so they were gassing themselves. But everybody scattered throughout downtown. They went over the bridges. They went towards the hotels. They went down in the downtown area. And the police tried to run them over and tried to kill people, really. And that fight did not end until 4 a.m. I was at 4 a.m. I was out down on October 6th Bridge. And that was the last group I saw. And you could see the thugs already forming to big groups. And I hightailed it back to the embassy, back to my hotel. And I didn't realize. I thought, well, that was one night. And for 3 days, there were little skirmishes around Cairo, all in different little areas. I went and saw them, and I was arrested at one, and then let go, and then arrested at another, and then let go. And all of a sudden, my friend called me again. She said, come on down to Shubra again. And I went down to Shubra, and I had no idea where I was going. She just could get off the metro and just walk up. And I walked up the metro, and I'm standing around. There's nothing going on. And all of a sudden, the mosque finished. They've finished their prayers. The imam finished his speech. And they hit the streets en masse on that Friday. And it was the most amazing thing. It was a fight. That 8 kilometers was not a walking anymore. It was tear gas and sticks and rocks, and everything was flying, and tear gas was everywhere, and you were being dragged into little alleys and then thrown out of little alleys, and all kinds of crazy things happened. But the people made it back to Tahrir Square that day, and they never let it go. From that day on, they never let it go, and it was truly freaking amazing. And I'll just tell you one more story, because I'm sure you're bored of it. But I'm sitting outside. I was looking outside of my hotel room, and my hotel room is 200 meters down, like maybe to that grassy area from Tahrir Square. And I'm up like 3 floors, and I'm looking out. And the people now, they've formed these things where they form lines across, people lines across the street, Pelletharp Street. And you had to go through, and you literally had to show your passport. And they frisked you for weapons, but you were happy to do it. I'm like going, frisk me, baby. I love it. You know, I don't like cops doing it, but I love it when my brothers are doing it. And the sisters went over here, and the brothers went over here. And you walked through, but I looked out my window, and there was that people line. And suddenly, from around the other, from Pelletharp Square, cut down Pelletharp, you could see 50 thugs, just mean people that you see every day on the streets of Cairo, these undercover cops. And they had rocks. And they got 30 feet away, and they'd throw rocks, and the people just stood there. They had nothing. They were getting pelted with rocks. And these thugs got closer and closer and closer with these rocks until they were this close, throwing rocks at people that were doing absolutely nothing. This is how committed these people were. People started running from, they knew what was going on, and they had a great communication system. People started running from Tahrir, and they came up and they put their own blankets in front of the people to stop the rocks from hitting them. But these thugs kept going. And finally, from behind, they had organized a bunch of rocks, and they threw the rocks to the thugs, and they ran like you've never seen anybody scatter. They scattered throughout Cairo, and it was street battles. From that point on, it just kept going and kept going. Until, I don't know if any of you know Kit, but Kit came to Cairo because she was one of the people who was going to go on the trip to Gaza. And we went down to the place where the police finally hid in like an area because the military came in and said, get out of here. and the police were hiding down there, and we went down to look at them, and they were literally firing live rounds at people. If they poked their head out, they'd fire. So it was absolutely crazy. One last message is the Egyptian people, I mentioned to the people that we should march with the cops, and it's not for religion. The people are saying now in Egypt, the people, the young people, the people that started these Tahrir Square marches, or the occupation of Tahrir Square, the government still has martial law in Egypt. And they are saying the reason we need martial law still in Egypt is because we need to protect the people. And the Egyptian people are now saying, you cannot protect the Egyptian people. People have been murdered en masse with your officers standing around. It's time for you, for the military to step down and allow a civilian government and end martial law.
Yeah.
Thank you, Ty. I'm Margaret Flowers. I'm one of the initial organizers of this occupation of Freedom Plaza. Who's new to Freedom Plaza? Who's here for the first time? Awesome. Thank you so much. So we're waiting for our friends from the 6th of April movement to get here, but I wanted to tell you a little bit about the October 2011 movement. When we were first organizing this, we started back in April, we realized that this what's happening in the United States is not just important for the United States, it's important for the entire world. And so we wrote an open letter to our global allies where we said that we understand that our revolution is your revolution because our foreign policy, our military policy, interferes with your ability to have self-determination and economic stability. And that was published in Al Jazeera and went around the world. A few months ago, during the summer actually, we were in contact with a group of the revolutionaries from Egypt. And we said, let's have a conference call and find out if there's any areas of solidarity that we could possibly come up with. So we did this conference call through Skype, and we found four areas of solidarity. We said that both Egypt and the United States, would like to have a real democracy. A real democracy where you actually get to choose candidates, not the corporate candidates, but real candidates, and that votes are counted and our voices are heard. The second thing we said is that we would like to end the current type of foreign policy, U.S. foreign policy, which is interventionist, and be more cooperative and more collaborative. We found out from our Egyptian friends that of the U.S. aid that goes to them, 80% of that goes to U.S. corporations. So it's not really for them, it's just expanding our market into their area. The third area is that we would like our human needs to be met. We all want education, jobs, healthcare, housing, the basics. And then the fourth item was around human rights abuses. Because human rights abuses are occurring not just in Egypt, they're occurring here in the U.S. and we're causing them in other areas of the world. So we want human rights abuses to be documented and those who carry them out to be held accountable for them. We want them to be stopped. So we drafted a letter together and it was signed by people in the United States as well as people in Egypt, and that's gone around the world as well. So this really is about something that's much bigger. But what's happening here in Freedom Plaza and around the country and around the world is really tremendous, because when we started organizing this, we never dreamed there would be a whole Occupy movement. We've been talking about a global day of action. Our friends in Spain called for October 15th to be a global day of action months and months ago. But we never dreamed it would be what it was. There were, I think, around 1,000 cities around the world in 82 countries. And we saw pictures all around the world that said 99%. We are the 99%. All over the world. And people used Occupy. There was Occupy Tokyo. You know, Occupy all sorts of cities all around the world. So that's very exciting. What this is that, and one person from Egypt who was interviewed in an Egyptian journal about our letter of solidarity, I think put it very well. They said that from now on, our relations, our international relations, are going to be conducted civilized society to civilized society instead of government to government. So this is truly a transnational people's movement. And we do have have the resources and the power, and this is the beginning of what's going to be a very long struggle. It took us a long time to get into this position. They snuck in this corporate coup while we weren't watching, and now we have to turn that around. But this is the first step. It's coming out into public and talking about it, saying that these are the issues that we're concerned about, that it's not acceptable anymore, that we continue on the path that we're going down, and that we as people are going to change that. So I want to thank the people that are here in Freedom Plaza, staying here with us. It's turning into a wonderful community. But for those of you who are new to Freedom Plaza, please make sure that you give us your email address. Please check our website. We're having events down here regularly. We're having workshops and classes and community discussions on various issues. Tomorrow night at 7 o'clock, we're having an evening about Iraq. We'll have food and music and dancing and a panel that talks about Iraq. We'll be discussing the latest decision to pull troops out of Iraq. Is that really a good thing, and what does that really mean? So I see that our friends from Egypt are here, and if Maria's ready, we'll go ahead and introduce them. So thank you so much.
We were on Egyptian time. We were learning about the Middle East. So I'll start if the three of you just want to approach. And of the Egyptian youth movement. This is Bassem Fathi, who's been involved. He's going to give you an introduction, and then the rest will end up taking questions, so please, we want this to be, you know, a discussion. So this is Bassem Fathi, and he's been involved in, you know, numerous different, I don't know how closely people follow Middle Eastern politics here, but involved with all the different opposition groups in Egypt. All have done activities at great risk to themselves, but obviously to their families, so definitely true believers. And this is Esra Abdelfattah, and she, actually all of them, I think you should have a round of applause in the sense they were all finalists for the Nobel Peace Prize this year. And this is Esra, so she's obviously a female activist and has been involved more with social media, and is sort of known as the Facebook girl in Egypt. So for her time, sorry, can everyone hear me?
Yeah.
For her time advertising the original April 6th strike in 2007. And then Ahmed Maher is the co-founder and current leader of April 6th. And for those of you that aren't familiar with April 6th, Ahmed can go in more depth, or actually any of them. It's the youth movement, but there's also a convergence of labor groups, and it's a coalition in a sense of secular opposition groups. So. I'm going to let Bassem talk, give a brief introduction, and then the rest will take questions.
Hello, everybody, and hello. Thank you for such warm welcome. We are really inspired by what you're doing. Let's correct something. Actually, our movement, it was leaderless, the same like yours, and this was a strength point for our work, and actually, it was a kind of very close to real democracy, for having just the people, the collective mind of the people who are just deciding to do what is in the favor of the people. That's why we're really inspired by what you're doing. Let's say that we started what we were doing in order to get the basics of democracy and rights in our countries, but in the same time we're really inspired by what you're doing, because seemingly you are trying to correct democracy,
yeah,
to put it on the same pathway, to put it in the form that should it be. Nothing else to say. Thank you, and all our solidarity. If there's any question or something, Ahmed and Isra are gonna answer your questions.
Maybe it's better if people just come up.
You just repeat the question.
Not question, Moses. What difficulties do y'all see in wresting control from the military to civilian control?
So what difficulty do you see transitioning from military to civilian control?
My opinion, the first problem that the military don't want real democracy in Egypt, and they also try to control the next regime because from 1952 the military controlling everything in Egypt, so it's hard for them to make full control to civilians. And I think the U.S. administration is also agree with that to cooperate with the military, to cooperate with CAF in Egypt, and don't cooperate with the people in Egypt, like what happened before the revolution. Full support to Mubarak, and now full support from U.S. to SCAF. But we're still there. We will complete our struggle to change the regime. The regime is not Mubarak. The regime is the mentality, the law, the constitution, and behavior, and everything. So we will complete our struggle, and we will be there until real changes happen in Egypt.
I would like to add concerning that very important question is that basically Egypt is a country that has been void of any NGOs, any civil political system. It was sabotaged for 60 years. Therefore, when unexpectedly there is an uprising that happened, and that uprising developed to be a revolution, there was a great vacuum, and that vacuum was filled by the military, who has been in control, as my friend said, for 60 years. And now when you have countries that are not institutionalized and there is no rule of law, or the rule of law is very weak, then whoever has the gun, it is physical, it is more physical. So that is the basic difficulty that we are having now. Now, these young guys that you, young people that you see here who are representing the new trend in Egypt, which is a democratic trend, it goes against the mainstream culture also, which is people who have been brought up under totalitarian regimes, not only in a political sense, but also in a cultural sense. And that is the most difficult part of it. Now, the authorities in power, gaining or having all the resources like mass media and so on, and let us not forget that there are a lot of Gulf money that are poured into our country right now to bring it back to its traditional thing. So these young people are really fighting a lot against a lot of odds. That's the basic difficulty. Since we are here and we are talking to this distinguished group of revolutionary guys in the United States of America, I would like to bring to your attention the fact that even though it may look for the short run that America should go for quote-unquote stability, because America does not, Americans officials tell us, well, whom are we talking to? Whom are we going to talk to? There is a vacuum, that's true. However, that could be good for the short run. For the longer run, it really is not that good at all. And that applies to many countries in the Middle East. And thank you for being patient listening to me.
Any more questions? Please.
My name is Michael Beard. Do you have advice for us?
Okay, Ahmed having a advice. My advice, that don't accept any advice from anyone. We can't copy an experience to another country. Your mentality is not my mentality. Your goals are not my goal. Maybe we have a common interest with me and you, or with the people in Egypt and you, but also you have to make your experience. You have to find a way to make a real pressure on the that regime, and what happened to can apply the social justice in the United States. So you must to find solutions to have your experience, and also maybe to see what happened in many countries, like
what happened in Arab countries, what happened in Eastern Europe. We got learning from the experience in Eastern Europe, but we make our experience and make our revolution is different from what happened to Eastern Europe. So I think you can see everything, you can learn from everything, but you must make your experience. Thank you.
Maybe I want to add one advice, because we are suffering now from many difficult things. The first thing which make you continue your road is to be one hand. All of us to be one hand until you achieve everything you want. Make your demands your leader. Not you choose the leader from you, but still continue your struggle until your demands achieved. You cannot choose one for you from you now to say what you want and what you can do, but your demands must be your leader. Shukran. Thank you.
For me, I just want to say that nothing is impossible. Yani, for us, we were a very small group, we're working under very drastic conditions, just working for our dreams, and seemingly the same is your case. Again, you are challenging a very well-set establishment and behavior and thinking, but at the end of the day, nothing is impossible. Another question here, okay. Six, okay, fine. Okay, please, ask, okay.
Your point about one hand sort of answers my question in part, but I'd like to go further into it. What are you learning about yourselves as human beings on the planet? What kind of new thing are you learning about yourselves?
I mean, for us, the activists who were working for years before, nothing new, but let's say that it was a real, it was something great to see the people that we already thought at some time that they will never engage with us. They are engaging. We had like 10 million in the streets of and the squares of Egypt during the 18 days of the revolution. And before this, every single analyst, not only in Egypt, but all over the world, saying that Egyptians will never do this. And they did. So, I mean, the people are not limited, not restricted, and they can do everything.
I was in the April 6th offices after the raid that took place during the revolution, and they destroyed the office, and they arrested many people, and I know that there are still many hundreds of people who are in prison in Egypt, and I wonder if you still have people from the April 6th movement in jail, and if we can do anything to help them, or what are your plans to get them out?
Yes, during the 18 days in Sidi Tahrir Square, they attacked the office of, through the office of every sex, it was the Human Rights Center, and we use that to have our central group and central communication group. But they all released after Mubarak leaves, but now they arrest students, have 18 years old, because he drawing graffiti on the wall against the people from the previous regime, because they want to running for parliament elections again. So they keep him in the jail till now about 5 days because he's drawing graffiti on the wall. And I think we need your support to make him release. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Maria. Thank you for being here. I'm wondering about U.S. Policy toward Egypt and also U.S. Support of Israel, how that has been a problem, if it has, in your revolution in your country. Have you had to surmount things about our really corrupt foreign policy practices?
Maybe I want to say that is, we hope that is after our revolution, the U.S. policy will be changed, and they will believe in people rather than in leaders or dictatorial leaders, but U.S. Leaders or decision makers, and we say to them that is, we need to make a balance between your relationship between the leaders.